welcome everyone. Merry Christmas. It's not too early, even though there's no snow on the ground. Look around, get in the Christmas spirit a little bit here. Welcome to another Sunday here at Voyage Church. So happy to have each and every one of you join us. It's a real blessing, especially times like these, to get together and praise God. Before we get going, let's bow our heads and open with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, your God in heaven, we thank you so much for this morning and that you're here with us to guide us and open our hearts to hear from your word, to hear a message about you, about who you are and about us as well, so that we would be just transformed, God, so that we could more and more resemble you in our lives. And Father, as I speak from your holy word today, I pray that my words would be the ones that you've chosen for the people here and for all of us here. And if anything I say is not of you, then may it just fall to the floor and not have impact. God, may only your truth ever resound in people's hearts. In Christ's name, amen. Well, as Ben had pointed out, we are starting a new series here for Christmas, The Glory of the Incarnation. Incarnation is kind of a big word. If you aren't familiar with that word, or at least what it means here in the church context, good, because that's kind of part of why we chose it, is hoping to kind of like, you know, expand our understanding of things, right? So incarnation, and maybe you have heard that word before, though, and it just doesn't really quite make sense to you. That's great. Basically, in very most simplistic way I could say, incarnation is God the Son coming down and taking on a human nature, becoming Jesus Christ, truly God, truly man. And that's what Christmas is about, right? We celebrate the birth of Jesus, which is the incarnation. And as we go over the next few weeks through December, we're going to explore why the incarnation, why Christmas is so important, how that impacts our lives, and really why that's like why we're all here right now, right? As a church, it's because it starts with the incarnation. And really to get started with that, you know, everything kind of tends to happen for a reason, right? Everything has a cause that happens, and it's the same thing with the incarnation, right? So why do we have an incarnation? Why did God have to come down and become man? So the need of the incarnation is the title of today's sermon. I want to get this maybe, put it back to something we can relate to. I'll put it to something we can relate to. If you look back, maybe recently or any time in your past, I'm sure there are moments where you have gotten yourself into trouble. You've gotten yourself into trouble, and you can't get yourself out. You need help, right? Sometimes we call it a mistake or we did something bad, but really, let's be honest, through some sort of selfish decision or behavior, right, which is wrong. We've talked about that. If you've been here before, we've heard that common theme that when we act out of our own self and our self-interest first, bad things happen, right? And we call that sin here in church. And when we act in these ways, we can sometimes get ourselves in trouble because, let's face it, when we put ourselves first, other people get hurt. Bad things can happen. And we all have, at some point in our lives, done that, whether it be in, you know, like, saying something really hurtful, but felt good to you, but hurtful to someone else. Maybe you borrowed something of somebody's and were careful with it, broke it, lost it. Maybe at work you caused an accident or something. I have a story that came to my mind when I was thinking of this. So just for a little bit of setting, I grew up in a very small town, about 900 people, a few hours away from any really what you might call a city. So essentially driving, having a car was essential. And so as soon as you turn 16, where I'm from in Alberta, you get your license and your parents usually buy you a beater and you have your car. And you drive every day to high school. Because if you don't have a car and drive to high school, then you're kind of nobody. And so you want to be cool. So you have your car. And because, you know, at your lunch break for half an hour, there's nothing to do at a small school like I went to, all people in high school take their car and drive around town, just up and down Main Street, for half an hour, because that's a lot of fun. So this is my high school life. And when I was 17, I remember it was February 2005. So I'm driving, I have my buddy in the passenger seat driving a beat up Jeep Cherokee, and I'm coming down to an intersection. And it's the one boulevard in town, right? And so a boulevard is that type of road that has that kind of patch of grass coming down the middle of it. And of course it's February, so there's snow piled high. Well, I'm a teenager, driving up to no good on his lunch break. Of course, I pull up to the stop sign, and, you know, I'm kind of having fun, a little bit reckless, a little bit careless, a rolling stop, because it's a small town. Who could be around the corner? As I pass that giant pile of snow in the middle of this street, I look over at my buddy in the passenger, and what do I see out of the window? A nice gray sedan coming straight for me. Bang! I got T-boned, and my buddy was able to take his hand and stick it right out the door because of how the indent in the side of my car. Thankfully, nobody was hurt, but I didn't know that, and that really, I could have caused a lot of pain for some people if you think of the impact that happened at that day. But I got out of the car, and I go around to see who am I in trouble with, because it's my fault. They didn't have a stop, and I did. So I get out of the car, and I look around, and it's a lady, about 75 years old. So it could have been really bad at that age being in an accident. I don't know what I'm in for, but if she gets out, remember, it's a small town, 900 people. She takes about, look at me, look like this. I can see that frustration and that anger melt as she recognizes me. I don't know who she is, but she recognizes me. And oh, now we're having a conversation about how my day's been going. What's new? How's my family? Lo and behold, this woman happens to be the mother of a guy that I work with who's in his 50s, and he happens to be my neighbor. Now, insurance rates for young high school guys in Alberta are incredibly high. Not like here in Quebec. So I'm up for a big problem, because as soon as this gets reported, my parents are going to get really angry, because of course they're paying my insurance. What does she do? She comes to me as we're talking, looking at her car, looking at mine. She was in it's a pretty bad accident for a woman in her late 70s. And she goes, you know what? I'm going to take this to the mechanic. I'll get an estimate. You pay me cash, and I won't tell anybody. Well, I'm not saying that's what we're supposed to do, right? She's supposed to report this. That's the legal thing to do. But in that moment, I was in trouble. I was in trouble, and I needed help, because I was going to get some severe trouble for this. And she helped me. She showed me some grace. And she stuck true to her word. She didn't tell the mechanic anything about what happened. But we all kind of have these moments, right, where we're really stuck, and we got nothing. We need a hand. We need a helping hand. See, my behavior, face it, it's not a mistake, right? It's not just a mistake where no one can get blamed. I was reckless. I was careless. I was proud, right? I was a teenage kid, and I thought that, you know, I was thinking of just for myself in my moment, and I wasn't being safe, thinking about someone else getting hurt as I drive through an intersection. We can all look at those moments and realize that those things we call mistakes and try not to blame ourselves for really, at the end of the day, are our fault. It's our selfish behavior. And really, what we're doing is playing out the world's greatest mistake ever. We're gonna look at that right now, because this greatest mistake of all time is the reason that we had the incarnation of God. If you turn with me, we're gonna flip to Genesis chapter 3. I know everyone's kind of, I think most people are quite familiar with this story, even if you're not familiar with Scripture, with Christianity. It's the story of Adam and Eve. It's the story of the fall. So as we know, just to pick up, God has created, everything's created, creation, and he's made Adam and Eve the first humans, and they live in this place called the Garden of Eden, right? So it's kind of like paradise on earth. It's this little area where they can kind of live happily. Fruit grows on trees. They get to eat it. The animals are tame. They get to hang out there. And God is there. He walks with them in the garden. So there's this sense of close fellowship with God. It's kind of what we all hope for, really, if we're dreaming about life. But now we come to chapter 3. Now the serpent was the most cunning of all the wild animals that the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman being Eve, did God really say you can't eat from any tree in the garden? Which isn't true, right? And the woman responded to the serpent. She said, well, we may eat the fruit of the trees in the garden, but about the fruit of the tree in the middle of the garden, that one tree, right? God said, you must not eat it or touch it, or you will die. No, you will not die, the serpent replied to the woman. In fact, God knows that when you eat it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. And the woman saw that the tree was good for food, delightful to look at, and that it was desirable for obtaining wisdom. So she took some of its fruit, and she ate it. She also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it. And there we have it. And that's the world's biggest mistake. And that's the first act of disobedience on behalf of humanity to God. But what really sticks out when I read this, and I think if we all look at it together, we can relate to this. Eve is really acting out of a desire for good, right? And that we can kind of relate to that. There aren't too many people that live out life thinking, how can I mess somebody up? How can I be bad or experience evil today? Not too many people wake up with that inclination. We all kind of hope for good things, right? In some fashion or another, like going back to my story of the car, you know, at that point in time, as I'm driving through and driving around town, I think it's good to kind of show that I'm a little bit, not really a scaredy cat, bang the lock because I want to look cool. I want something good. I want to hurry up and get on with my day. I understand that that's good. I'm wrong. We'll get to that later. But I feel like it's good. I want what's good. And we sometimes act like that when we're careless or we're self-centered. We're still thinking in terms of what is good. So Eve does this as well, too, right? She's looking at this tree and the fruit. It looks good. It looks like it's going to taste. It's going to taste good. It's going to be good for you, good for, strength and whatever, good nutrition. It looks nice, right? There's that appreciation for the beauty of the fruit and of the tree. And as the serpent says, it's going to make her wise, right? That's good. I'm going to grow in my knowledge and experience, right? It's the knowledge of good and evil. And what we understand with this, when they mean knowledge here, they're talking not so much about propositional knowledge like facts. It's more of a familiarity of an experience. She wants to experience and to be familiar with this goodness that is supposedly going to come from this fruit. Now, if you've ever heard anyone kind of talk about this story before, it's commonly focused on the fact that the serpent says, you'll be like God, knowing good and evil. And then there's this understanding that, oh, Eve and Adam, they just want to be like God. And there definitely is this proud element there, this self-centered element, of course. But before they even eat the fruit, we already see Eve taking the position of God. They're already putting themselves in God's place. Because what is she doing? God has said, look, here's this tree, here's this fruit. It's bad. Don't touch it. It's not good for you. And she goes around and says, well, you know what? Actually, it is good. It is good, God. It's good for food. It's good to make me wise. She is making a moral judgment contrary to what he has already declared. She's already putting herself in God's place before acting. And that is something we all do as well. When it comes to any type of disobedience to God, we're not doing it necessarily because we think something's wrong, we want to act wrong, but we are doing things and saying that it's good when God has said that it is not good. And that's always what it comes down to, is putting ourselves in God's place and taking that, usurping that moral authority that God has and putting our own thoughts and opinions and beliefs in front of it. But then look on what happens. We'll jump down to next verse. In verse 7 it says, then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they knew they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. So they wanted to experience goodness, right? They wanted to really be familiar with the good that would come from this fruit, but what do they get instead? They don't get goodness. No. They experience the opposite. They experience the evil. They're filled with awareness of their nakedness, no covering, and shame. Right, they have that experience. That's why they have to cover themselves up, because now they feel in themselves the disobedience. They feel all of a sudden in themselves this fall that has happened. They realize that they have disobeyed God. And it's like that sinful nature, that selfish desire and drive that we all have to fight against in life, that has kind of blossomed inside their hearts. And so they cover up and they hide. And that's, again, I don't know what happens in a lot of our moments of disobedience, where we act and we think that it's going to be good, and then the result isn't. Now, sometimes we can get lucky, and we see that right away, right? If you're having an argument with somebody maybe, and, you know, really, maybe they're being a jerk or something, and we know that really the selfless thing would be to show love. You know, when someone acts out negatively and wrongfully to you, to respond in love to them and give them grace and forgiveness. It's really hard, and it feels good to just kind of club them back, you know, hit back, fight back, one-up them, this feels good. But very quickly, as the argument just keeps going and getting worse, we realize that this isn't feeling good anymore because I just keep getting whacked back and forth and I'm just making the situation worse because I'm just feeding more sin and negativity into the moment. So we can kind of see that our desire for what makes us feel good doesn't. And we can learn from that. But sometimes it takes a while, right? Sometimes if you some things like cheating and lying, it can take a long time for us to realize just how bad that's going to come back at us. Because lies and things like that, they can get hidden and get away from people's attention and knowledge. It just gets bigger and bigger. Like they say, like a lie kind of grows and grows and grows until the consequences that we reap are even greater than what they would have been at the beginning. We always reap what we sow in life at some point. And as we continually reap and act in disobedience and selfishness, eventually that does come back to us. And like Adam and Eve, realize that what we've done is wrong and we have to face the brutality of that of those consequences. And look at those consequences. But what happens next? Let's go to the next verse as we start to explore the consequences. So Adam and Eve, now they've heard the sound of God walking in the garden. Right? Remember, God is still in the garden with them. Right? He comes down and he has this intimacy with them. He's walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze, and they hid from the Lord God among the trees in the garden. So the Lord called out to Adam, and he said to him, "Where are you? Where are you?" Really, he's calling him out. "Get out here." And he said, Adam replies, "I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid. And so I hid." And then God asked, "Who told you that you were naked? Did you eat from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from?" And here we go. The man replied, "The woman you gave me, she gave me some fruit of the tree, and I ate it. It's not my fault, God." So the Lord God asked the woman, "What is this that you have done?" And the woman said, "It's not my fault. The serpent deceived me, and I ate it." We can relate to that too, right? What happens often when we do something we know we're not supposed to, and we're challenged on it, our first inclination often is to run and hide or protect ourselves. Somehow, if I can remove as much responsibility as possible, it's going to be easier on me. Right? We don't want to face the consequences of our actions. We want to get out of trouble. And that's what they're doing here, right? Really, Adam and Eve chose to eat the fruit that they weren't supposed to. That was their decision. They are culpable. They are responsible for their mistake, for their disobedience. But what does Adam do? He doesn't just blame his wife. He blames God. "God, it's your fault. You gave me her, which she tricked me. So really, at the end of the day, it's all on you." He won't take responsibility. Eve does the same thing. "It's that serpent over there." I can tell you, I'm talking about myself a lot today with the story of driving. This is terrible. But I can tell you, for days after that accident, I was pretty angry with the city workers that decided to pile snow in the middle of a boulevard. Like, how was that public safety? I was fuming for days because, really, it shouldn't have been my fault. Honestly. But really, take time away from the situation and we realize that we are responsible for our own actions. We make a choice. We always have a choice, no matter how hard it is. And often we choose that selfish, disobedient option. And we jump down to verse 24, we can see the full repercussion of what Adam and Eve had done. It says, God drove the man, Adam and Eve, out of the garden and stationed the cherubim and the flaming whirling sword east of the Garden of Eden to guard the way to the tree of life. So basically they have been banished, rejected. They're no longer able to go back to this paradise. And this is where they were able to have this close, proximate relationship with God. Not only that, right, in this place where, like, just the food grows on trees, you don't have to have this hard life, there is something that's called the tree of life there. Right? And this is what Adam and Eve would eat for their immortality. They kept eating this from this tree of life. And now they've been basically banned from going there. And that's crucially important thing because Remember, God said you will die if you eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And the devil said you won't die. Right? It's not that you would drop dead, but because God will ban you from the garden, humanity doesn't have access to this life-giving food that he had for them. And now Adam and Eve will experience decay, physical corruption leading to death, like we all do. And essentially that's where we stand today. As human beings, we grow old, we get sick, we break bones, and eventually we will pass away. This is the same result of that fall, being denied access to this life-giving sustenance that God had for us. And we stand just like Adam and Eve before God in this moment, filled with shame because we have taken on the sinfulness, the selfish drive and behavior that he had. Return with us, Paul, the Apostle Paul, in his letter to the Romans really reflects a lot. This is where we're going to go here just in a moment because he writes a lot comparing Adam with Jesus. And that's what we're driving at. So if we jump with me to his letter to the Romans in chapter 5. Chapter 5 and verse 12, he expresses it like this. Right, verse 12. Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, that one man is Adam, right? Just as sin entered the world through Adam and death through sin, because we don't have access to the tree of life, so death comes because of sin. In this way, death spread to all people because all sinned. What he's trying to express here is the sense of headship, and we're going to return to that later on in the chapter when we get there, but there's a sense of headship or representation. Because Adam was first, everyone that follows after him are born under him or born into him. He is like the great representative or the head of humanity. So we all are partakers of his disobedience. It becomes part of our nature. We call that fallen human nature, a corrupt human nature. It's not what was supposed to be, but it's what is. That's what we're stuck in. All right? And that's why we stand before God helpless. We too are in trouble because we act just like Adam acted, just like Adam and Eve. We do this constantly throughout our life. So we are before God just as helpless, just in need of grace, just in need of assistance. But then this is where we get to the hope. This is where God comes in and lends his hand. In verse 14, back down in Genesis 3, in verse 14, the Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, you are cursed more than any livestock and more than any wild animal. You will move on your belly and eat dust all the days of your life. So he curses the serpent. Then he says, I will put hostility between you and the woman, between your offspring and her offspring. He, that is the woman's offspring, he will strike your head and you will strike his heel. So what we have is a seed, an offspring, a descendant of Eve will become victorious over the serpent. Not just the serpent's offspring, but also him himself. So I kind of spilled the beans a little bit. Who is the serpent? We don't really see from this passage here in Genesis, we don't get to know who the serpent is. But if we jump to the back of the Bible, back in Revelation, let's just pop that up here. I'm not going to flip through. This is not easy. It says, so the great dragon was thrown out, the ancient serpent. In other translations, says the serpent of old, who is called the devil and Satan, the one who deceives the whole world, just like he deceived Adam and Eve. So the identity of the serpent is made clear that this is Satan, the great adversary. And the seed of Satan then are the powers of darkness. Powers of darkness, right? But what we have is a singular seed of Eve that will be victorious because it says he. And if we go back to verse 15, we can jump back there, right? He will strike your head. So there is an offspring. There is one person, God is saying, will come who will strike the head or be victorious over not just the powers of darkness, but Satan himself. This is that first hope, that first promise of an answer for Adam and Eve and their helpless state before God. We go back. Oh, if you go to the letter to the Hebrews, we can see that they clearly show us that this is Jesus. himself, as it says here. Now, since the children have flesh and blood in common, that is us, Jesus also shared in these. So Jesus, God the Son, took on flesh and blood, that common humanity. He has our fallen human nature as his own, so that through his death he might destroy the one holding the power of death, that is the devil, and free those, that is us, who were held in slavery all their lives by the fear of death. So Jesus takes on our human nature so that as he dies, we can be free, so he can be in our place, and that he can take Adam's place for us. We're going back to Paul's letter to the Romans, right? I want us to go back there again because I lost the page. All right. Because he really shows us and expresses for us how Jesus is really like the new Adam. I want to say the anti-Adam, but it doesn't say that in the Bible. It says the new Adam. Just as how we're born kind of in Adam as our representative, right? Now we have the opportunity to be removed from that and be under Jesus. So if we go to verse 18, it says, so then, as through one trespass, again, this is Adam's first sin, right? Through this one trespass, there is condemnation for everyone, right? Because we're all under Adam. We're all under that one sinfulness. Also through one righteous act, and this is Jesus, his righteous act of dying for us on the cross. Through his one righteous act, there is justification. Justification, that right relationship, that declaration that we're okay before God, leading to life for everyone. Just as through one man's disobedience, again, that's Adam's disobedience, the many were made sinners. Everyone who comes after Adam are made sinners. So also through one man's obedience, that's Jesus, his obedience to death on the cross, the many will be made righteous. And we're jumping down to verse 21, so that just as sin reigned in death, so also grace will reign through righteousness, resulting in eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Jesus, in his death on the cross for us, undoes Adam's curse for us. We get kind of transmitted from under him to being under Jesus, so that before God, we're no longer helpless. We're no longer helpless. Because that disobedience that we had before God is taken away. Jesus has taken that punishment for disobedience away from us on the cross. Now we can stand before God in a right relationship, in a relationship of love and forgiveness and mercy. And what's amazing benefit for us now, for all of us in this room, is that we're able to look back on this, right? This is in the past. Jesus came and died and rose again 2,000 years ago. And he reigns in heaven today. That means we can engage in this living relationship with him now, right now. Now, while it's not complete, right? Like, there still is brokenness in the world. We still screw up. We still act out of selfish behaviors. Other people still act selfishly towards us and hurt us, right? We suffer. It's hard. Things aren't complete, but things have been started. And we have access to God right now through Jesus Christ, where we can begin to live a new life, a life where, as Jesus has brought a new opportunity for us to move away from sinful behavior, to live for him and to live out his purposes in life and to resemble him in this life, we have access to that now. We just have to turn to him, right? God's offer of salvation is for everyone. We turn to him, we acknowledge that selfish core in each and every one of us and confess the wrongness of that, confess how that's disobedient to him, repent of that, turn away from that, and ask for God. And he is there with his hands out to take you in. This is the message of the gospel, and that's available at all times for everyone now. And that's a great blessing for us because we can start walking in the path of God. Now, we're going to go into a period of reflection. And if you're in that position right now where you don't have that relationship with God and you're curious, we can talk about that. If you feel like you've been called to that, know that there's nothing stopping you from going to him now and asking and speaking with him in prayer. And if that's something you want to do now, then this is a great opportunity. We give you that time now to do that. And if you've already engaged in this relationship, you're already walking with God and trying to resemble him and be transformed into his likeness in this life, then let's take this moment and reflect on how so very often, even now, we tend to walk in Adam's footsteps and not Jesus' footsteps. We so often slip up and still act selfishly. We still act out of a wrong behavior. But how so very often God is always there. Well, God, not so very often, always. God is always there giving us his forgiveness, giving us the way out. Right? Because he gives us far more than we deserve. So we can go to him with thankfulness and praise for all those opportunities where we've slipped up and screwed up, and he has said, it is okay. I love you and I forgive you. Brothers and sisters, let's do that together as we first, let's close in a word of prayer.